gentlemen. In just a moment, we're going to begin our services for Avant. We'll begin today's services with a song, but before I get started with that, I'd just like to ask if anybody's brought a cell phone with them today, could you please turn it off or silence it for our services? Thank you.
I family, and want to welcome you to the memorial this morning, honoring the life of Yvonne Dolores Peterson. My name is Tom Carmichael, and I'm a pastor in the area and a friend of the family, and we're going to start honoring her life with a song that we've been asked to perform, and the song is called Sky and Sea. And if you know the song, you're welcome to sing along with us. Let's pray together. Dear God, I pray for your grace and comfort today. I pray that you help us mourn together, to comfort each other as we miss Yvonne, and also to celebrate what she means to each person here. Amen. Tico's going to come up and read a passage from the book of Isaiah.
Right. actually read out of Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff that comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. When I was younger, that song, I think because you hear it so often, just kind of felt like, you know, well, I'm past the 23rd Psalm. But the older I get, the more comfort that I find in that. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And I hope that's a place that you can come to this morning. And this song is called Invitation Fountain. And it's not a misprint, it's actually spelled that way, because you look at that. Just talking about how if you're feeling weak, if you're feeling weary, come to the fountain. Thank you.
silent reading the obituary and have a copy there. And, oh, I do not. So you can take a moment to read, if you have not already, the obituary, the life of Yvonne Peterson. We're going to take some time to have some family and friends come up and give remembrances. We're going to start with Gail Black, who's going to come up and give her remembrances of her life.
Greetings to everyone. School in remembrance of my dear friend Tom. I wrote just a few things so I could stay focused. And I thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to say a few things in remembrance of a friend of God. Gene and Tico, dear brother, right there on my bed. Precious Aisha and Jeff, Tico and Joe, Jaden, dear Jaden, all of your wonderful friends, family, and some names I don't know, other names I will call. My heart is full, and for loved ones whom I haven't met, I wish to offer you condolences from my old son, Christopher, my dear daughter, Terry, and my niece, Rochelle, who some of you know. They expressed their love and their sadness over Miss Yvonne, whom they considered a friend. I met Yvonne on Jamie's 5th birthday. I had become Tico and Jean's neighbor about 16 years ago. 16 and a half years ago when I moved on Laundry Drive. And I was invited to come to Jaden's birthday, and that's where I met Yvonne. And little did I know that we would become really good friends. Birthdays, holidays, bridal showers, bachelorette parties, weddings. Just because it's time to have a cookout, I knew I would get a chance to see Yvonne. And we would buddy up, and we would talk about everything, and we would solve all the problems of the world. talk about how much we love Motown and who loved Barack Obama more.
Sure.
At the time of my own dear brother's passing, Yvonne demonstrated her love for me in a deep way. This was in 2012. She sent me a gift, a financial gift, and she ordered a honey-baked ham. I didn't expect that, but it came with her condolences. And she expressed to me how much she understood that a brother meant. And so that deepened our mutual affection and love for each other. When Yvonne moved to Sunrise here in Tucson, we got a chance to get together. I visited her a couple of times. We decided that we were gonna go and have lunch. Jean's heard this story, but I love to tell it, so allow me to repeat it. And we thought we would go out to a certain restaurant. When we got there, we didn't like the look of it. So we said, now what? We looked across the street, and there was a Chinese restaurant, and it was called Kung Fu Noodle. And we were like, we gotta go in there and check that out. We didn't know it was really a traditional provincial Chinese restaurant. And everyone spoke Chinese, and we didn't know what we were looking at on the menu. So we asked the waiter to help us order. And by the time we got everything, the table was filled. And we sat there and tasted and sampled everything, and we packed all the rest of it up and took it home to my home and then to her, of course, to her at Sunrise. And from then on, when I call her on the phone, I say, hi, this is Kung Fu Noodle. And she would just laugh, and we would have a thrill with that. We enjoyed that quite a bit. On my last two visits with Yvonne, we appreciated her grandson's art that was on the wall there. We talked about the chaplain who was there at Sunrise. I had started to do lay chaplaincy. And I asked Yvonne, you know, we've done a lot of things, we've talked about a lot of things. Would it be all right with you if we prayed together? This would be our first time praying together, you and I, and all this time. And she said, yes, sure. And we held hands, and we prayed, and we poured out our hearts to our Lord. And on the next visit, we did the same thing. We did our tours of the Dollar Tree, one of her favorite places, I tend to think. And we shared tender moments that are just hers and mine alone. But I want to leave you with two verses, one I shared with Yvonne and the other I share with you. The first one is Psalm 46 and 1, and it simply says, God is our refuge and our strength, and a very present help in trouble. And so I encourage all of us to seek God for the consolation that only He can give as we move into this time of adjusting to life without our loved one Yvonne. And second and last is a verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, and it simply says, may the God of all comfort, the God of all mercies, may the God of all peace comfort you. And may you take that same comfort wherewith you are comforted, and comfort one another. Thank you for the opportunity to share. May God bless each of you.
Has a memory or something that I'd like to share, please feel free to come up. And Aisha's going to, if we feel like everybody's kind of had a chance, if you want to come up, you don't feel like you have to. And then Aisha's going to deliver the eulogy after that. So feel free.
I name is Josette. For those that don't know me, I'm Tico's wife. TT would call you Little Tico. To Troy, I want to extend my condolences. And to Papa and Nana, Isha, and Tico, I'm so sorry. Jeff, and to the boys, Jaden, Jeffrey, Tico, and Isaiah. I met TT a while ago, many years ago, and it was funny the first time I met her, but I still remember Papa being so reserved, Nana being fun, and Yvonne being so outspoken. I remember when I met her, I'm like, wow, I love this family. She's crazy. And I remember her kind of checking me out to make sure I was okay for Tico. But she always had the kindest words, the best advice, and she didn't care if you wanted to hear her opinion or not, because she was going to give it. And I'm going to miss that the most. I think we celebrated many Christmases together, and she would cry at every white elephant exchange because she didn't get what she wanted. And I remember her stealing Jaden's gift. So the next year we had to separate the kids from the adults because of TT. And I think she even tried to steal her mom's white elephant gift. She got mad at us every time and cried, but it was always tears of joy. I remember when the kids were born, my kids, and I remember how proud she was that we named Tico the fourth. I still remember the days that she asked us to call her TT. And I'll never forget that she named our sons special in honor. She always saw something special in little Tico, and she gave Zaya the best name honor. And I challenge you too, when you're having your most difficult days in life, that you remember your TT, then you remember that pineapple upside down cake that broke and how much she cussed. But how much you enjoyed it. And Tico, I know that the loss of Yvonne is very tough for you and Isha and Troy. But know that she'll always be with you guys, and those memories and those crazy stories. I'm just so privileged to have known her. And I thank you guys for the memories. And TT, you will be missed and forever loved. Thank you.
Good morning to everyone. I'd just like to share a few memories that I have about Yvonne. Yvonne and I were always very close while we were growing up. We were only like 14 months apart in age, so we were going to the same schools together. You know, we were getting our driver's license and different things like that together. I went into the service. Shortly after I got out, she wanted to move to California where we were going to be located. So we spent a lot of time together, Yvonne and I and my wife Jean. We practically grew up together, the three of us, out of California, Arizona, and in Detroit. But anyway, as we were growing up, I'll never forget this one incident where Yvonne and I used to walk to school all the time. And it was, I guess, about 12 blocks, about a mile to the school. And so we would walk to school every day. And there was this one yard that had a dog that you used to bark at us all the time when we walked past, and the dog was in the fence, you know. So we didn't care, you know, we never worried about the dog doing anything, you know, we were protected, so we thought. And then one day we were walking to school and we walked past that yard, and all of a sudden, well, before I get to that, Yvonne used to tease the dog while I was behind the fence. She used to make fun of the dog and go up to the fence and yell at the dog and just really pick at the dog. And this one day, going to school, Yvonne, the dog got out. And all of a sudden, we noticed that and we took off running. And I mean, we were really running too. And the dog was catching up with us, and I realized it, and I said, Yvonne, just stop, let's see if it goes past us. But she wouldn't stop. She just kept running, you know, and I stopped, and the dog went right past me, and I said, well, that was nice, you know, no problem here. And Yvonne just kept going, and the dog went after her. The dog eventually caught up to Yvonne, and it bit her. And you know, after I stopped and seen the dog was still chasing Yvonne, I sort of ran after both the dog and Yvonne to try to help Yvonne, because I knew it wasn't going to be very pretty. But anyway, the dog just bit her and took off, you know, and that's all the dog wanted, is just to get back at Yvonne. Anyway, that was just one of the many incidents that we had as kids growing up. Yvonne got her, well, I got my driver's license, and Yvonne didn't have hers yet, but she went out and bought a car. So I ended up driving the car all the time, and that was really nice because I couldn't afford a car, and I was just getting my driver's license. But she was so free-hearted that, you know, the car was basically mine until she got her driver's license, which was about 6 months later. And being so young and foolish and all that, I wrecked a car for her, you know? And I never kept any gas in it. She would have to keep the gas in it. But she didn't mind, you know. She was just really, very free-hearted and very kind. And I didn't realize. I hope I wasn't taking advantage of her anyway. But anyway, we had a lot of good times in growing up, and after we had grown up as well. And she is definitely going to be missed, and on behalf of Jean and myself, you know, we love her and we'll always miss her. And we wish that she hadn't gone so young. Thank you very much.
Dwight Whitfield, Yvonne's brother, and I remember all those things Tika was talking about, and I also remember her car. Yvonne was really ambitious, and she really strove to get a lot of things, okay, and her car, she graduated from high school, she worked, she got a car, she got a lot of things. She was very ambitious and everything. But anyway, I'll try to be as brief as I can about what I'm going to say. But like Tico said, she was very kind-hearted, she had a really big heart. And that's what I remember most about her. In fact, that's what I love most about it. I can recall I was living in Detroit, and too moved to California. I could go do the research and give you details about the migration, about the move to California, but we don't need to go through all that. But I moved to California in the 70s, just like a lot of people moved to California in the 70s. But I'm not going to tell you about the large migration of the move to California. I'll focus on my move to California. And part of my move to California was for my own particular reason, but I moved there, and I moved there with Yvonne, out of the kindness of Yvonne Hart to allow me to move there with her. And part of that reason is that I really wasn't doing anything productive in Detroit. And I needed to really get my life together. And she gave me the opportunity to do that. When I say I wasn't doing anything in Detroit, I wasn't doing anything. Nothing. So I came to Los Angeles and enrolled in school. And she let me stay with her until I got on my feet and enrolled in school. Okay, after that, I finally got on my own and started going to school. Was at UCLA. And while I was going to UCLA, it's a funny thing, man. When I was going to UCLA, they had a policy there, you know, for students. You know, if you had a checkbook, you know, they had a policy and you needed a little extra bucks or something, you know, you could take your checkbook to the student union and say, well, you know, I need a few extra dollars. And they said, well, you got a checkbook? Oh, I got a checkbook. You got some empty checks in your checkbook? Oh yeah, I got plenty of empty checks. Not a lot of money, but I got empty checks. So I would write some checks, and they give me money. Predate my checks, and they give me money. My tuition was fine. I paid my tuition and everything. But anyway, when I was getting close to graduation, you know, and I was getting ready to go to Kenya to teach school over to Kenya, I got kind of carried away and everything. But to make a long story short, I accumulated somewhat of a bill. But as I accumulated that bill, what happened? I graduated and I went to Kenya. All right, after I came back to Kenya, from Kenya, okay, I came back and I came back to Tucson. And I went to the University of Arizona, right here in Tucson, I'm speaking. Yeah, I went there and I took a couple courses at the graduate level. Did quite well, got a couple A's. And anyway, then I went back to Michigan and I applied for University of Michigan, I believe. But anyway, I was accepted at the University of Michigan and everything. Well, I was accepted here in Arizona, at the University of Arizona. But when I left school to get my grades at the University of Arizona, they threw my banana. And they denied my admission, but they admitted me temporarily because of the fact that I had a degree from UCLA. But then, when it came to getting my grades and everything, they denied it. And then, subsequently, they denied my admission to the University of Arizona. Why? How many of you see LA? I couldn't get my transcripts. I couldn't get my degree from them. Remember the checkbook? Checkbook. Came back on me. They holding back on it now. Not only that, now that
about to get into the University of Michigan, they're holding it back on my admission for the same reason. Writing notes, post-dated checks. Okay, so I talked to Yvonne, same one who let me stay with her when I first started my college career at UCLA. And I told her the predicament I'm in. Okay, not only am I losing the University of Arizona, I'm also losing the University of Michigan. A double whammy. Okay. And she said, well, what do you need? I said, well, I owe something to UCLA. UCLA, absolutely. I tried to negotiate with them. I told them I was an African teaching school. I tried to get a deferment. I tried to do everything. They wouldn't do it. They just won't settle anything. And she said, well, what do you need? I said, well, I owe them a little money and stuff like that. She said, well, look, I'll take care of that. And I think she's still in LA. And she says, how important is it to you? I said, very important. You know, because I won't be able to get back in school. Okay, she says, how soon do you need? I said, I really need it right away. So she said, okay, I'll go up on campus and pay it. And she actually went on campus at UCLA. I was in Detroit. She went on campus at UCLA, paid for it. Took the time out to go on campus for whatever she was doing, working or whatever, paid it. And that got me into the graduate program at the University of Michigan. I later excelled there. But I'll tell you this, I never did get my transcripts or my acceptance at the University of Arizona. I never got it. Two A's. It's not that I'm running from them. I could use that. Who could not use that? Okay. You know, but she just went up there. She paid for it. I got it to University of Michigan. But her heart. You know, I often ask myself, what have I ever done for her to bail me out? Not once, but twice. She bailed me out when I was in Detroit, wasn't doing anything. She bailed me out when I was in Detroit the second time trying to get in the University of Michigan. I haven't done anything to really deserve it. Really. But I don't know. She went out her way. She didn't only send him a check. She went down on campus to the office of the registrar and paid it. That got me on campus. And I managed to graduate from the University of Michigan. I regret now what happened at the University of Arizona because they gave me the confidence at the University of Arizona because they gave me the confidence to know I could do graduate work. And I think that's what helped me excel at Michigan. And it helped me not only excel at Michigan, but all the way through my doctor's degree. She helped me excel through my doctor's degree. She gave me the confidence to know there's no obstacle too big for you to hold you back. You can do it. All you have to do is do it. Just do it. That was the attitude. The you want to achieve something, just get out there, take the first step. Do it. And achieve. She had a great big heart. And I'm going to miss her. Thank you.
I'll make this brief. I just wanted to come up and really extend my condolences to the family, to Troy. I'm sorry. Lost mom. My dad, my mom, my uncles, my brothers, my sister, family, cousins. And I want to say that, you know, TT left a piece of her in me, as I'm sure she has for everyone that she touched. You know, she had this zeal for life. We saw it in the pictures, you know, that were playing before the session. I think we got to see a piece of her soul every time we got to visit her. You know, the kids, boys, love to see TT and love spending time with her. Because she was so genuine. You guys talk about how free and hard she was, and she was all that and more. You know, she was, you always saw who she really was. She didn't hold back. And I appreciated that about her. And I think she was always like that. I knew her, I've known her really all my life, since California, you know. In California, she was there. We moved to Arizona, and she was there. And, you know, when I graduated college and moved to Phoenix, you know, I got to live with her for a while. She was there. You know, when we graduated, she was always there. And I think for the younger ones, you know, we try to really teach them how to express themselves. And she was the epitome of what that means. She did it lovingly. You know, she never did it out of spite, but she would tell you exactly how she felt. And I always appreciated that about her. It hurts, you know, it's gonna leave a hole. You know, but that's something we can always take with us going forward. I'm appreciative of the fact that, you know, Janus has his aunt there to make him laugh. Grandma has her baby back, granddad, you know, those that have, you know, gone before her. And I'm sure TT's got them cracking up in heaven. And I'm very glad for her. But my condolences to my family. To her friends, and we're gonna miss her. Thank you.
When I read the little write up on Yvonne, it's exactly what I remember. She was the life of the party. Always cracking us up, telling jokes. And I came across this poem that I think captures her essence. And I'm gonna read it. Hopefully I won't choke up too much because these things are emotional for me. It's a poem by John Updike. Here it goes. And like I said, excuse me for choking up. And another regrettable thing about death is the ceasing of your own branded magic, which took a whole life to develop. And of course, it's on my phone. and market the quips, the witticism, the slant, adjusted to a few. Those loved ones nearest the lips of the stage, their soft faces blanched in a vault-like glow. Their laughter close to tears, their tears confused with her diamond ears. Their warm, full breath in and out with her heartbeat. Their responses in your performance twinned. The jokes over the phone. The memories packed in rapid access file. The whole act. Who will do it again? That's it. No one. Imitators and descendants aren't the same. Rest in peace, Yvonne.
What can I say about my mother? She was kind, sweet, generous. She cared about a lot of people. We had our tits, we had our tats. We had our disagreements. We had our agreements. She always told me to do the best that we could do. We had our good times. She always reminded me to work for the best. My brother, she always strived to do the best that she could do. That was a strong point that she had. And he carried on through me to strive to be a better person. Remember when we moved from Detroit down to California, we lived in a kind of like a rough neighborhood in Dickinson Gardens. I don't know if you guys know where that is or not. But it was pretty rough over there. And she strived to get out of that neighborhood for us. Moved to Inglewood and to better places. And then she came down to Phoenix. She accelerated down this way. I remember my wife and I, when we first got married, she didn't. She didn't like my wife, but eventually she grew older.
that there was my mother, she had come in. She was said to my wife, she loved all her grandkids. She missed all our values inside me, uncles, aunties. Here's my rock, my soul. She's still out of values. She was never the one to downgrade you. She always wanted to lift you up. Even the bad or the worst. And maybe she always said that if you want something, work for it. Well, that's why I have a lot of my heart from her. She always has told to me that you have to work for what you want. Good times, we had bad times. We had really bad times. But we was able to push through it. We made it through it, and I didn't agree with a lot of things she had to say. I didn't agree with a lot of things she thought. But it turned out to be words of encouragement. She taught me a lot of values. My uncles taught me a lot of values. My aunties taught me a lot of values. Ever since my mother and I, she did everything that she could do possibly to make sure we had a better life. She kept us out of bad neighborhoods. She looked out for everybody, for everyone. That's who my mother was. then when my wife and I, we first got married, she didn't like my wife. But my wife grew up on her. Because that's not the good heartedness that she had. A lot of people to her, close to her heart.
I'm his wife. It's hard for all of us to, even for me especially, because as my husband said, you know, Vaughn and I didn't, you know, see eye to eye at first when we first was married. She's over the years, she just accepted me as a daughter. That's what she would call me, her daughter. The daughter she never had. She gave so many wonderful, you know, advice to me. Difficult times that I really haven't been and really pushing, as everyone knows, is doing the best that you can as a person, as me, as a woman, excelling more. And those type of things, I'm definitely gonna miss. I'm just gonna miss talking to her and jokes, just making her laugh. Probably so crazy. So sorry to all our family, because we're gonna miss her. Miss her dreadfully.
Having a hard time, like, I haven't been able to make it up to the coffin because it's not a lot to me. It's just so full. Life, goodness, it just, even when she was in a hospital down and out, life exudes out of her. When she was asleep, I wish this was different, of course, but with COVID, we can't get together and share the love that we would be. The hugs and the kisses, we just holding of each other during this time. Also can't party like I know she would have liked, you know? She definitely would have been all about that. But I want to say, She's been sick for so many years. I've watched my parents, my mother, and my father do so much. No matter the time of the day, no matter the time of the night, they were there. It didn't matter if it was in Tucson, if it was in Phoenix, if everything needed to be dropped, it was dropped. And it went to her. To witness that dedication is overwhelming and awesome. And I only hope that I can be the kind of family member for those who need my help someday. They really were tireless and everything. I spoke to her and I spoke for her when she couldn't. And I thank you to all of the family that was here and friends that were here to support her during all those, throughout those years. She went up and down. We saw Yvonne in so many different phases of her wellness, of her life, of her sicknesses, and her coming back. And I think so much of what had influenced her into coming back was the social aspect of it, the strength of this family, the way that we can laugh and the way that we hold each other up. And once this hit, once this disease hit this year, it shut all that down. And we knew that it wasn't going to do any good for her. And we were scared for that. Yvonne said all the time, for years, if she wanted to be resuscitated, do everything you can to save my life, she would say. Do everything you can to save my life. And in the different ways that she had been suffering, I admit, I couldn't understand it. In the different ways that, not just the pain of her suffering, but what her life had become, knowing who she was compared to who she had become, being taken over by the sickness, I couldn't understand why she would say it. But within this week, I've gotten more in touch with it. I even told her, I said, Yvonne, you want everybody to do all this to save your life, but you're not living. You need to do for yourself. Get up, eat when you need to eat, walk around, do your exercises, live. Don't just lay around, you have to live. But what I'm beginning to understand, and I'm sure will continue past today, just the family, the presence, and the value, I can only suspect that it's because of the value she knew she added, that she would want to stay. Because when I walked in today, and I saw the coffin, her value increased 100-fold. So, we were very close, and Yvonne was my teacher, and she knew that about herself. She taught me so much, but she also delighted in knowing that she gave me new insights to life. And as she would give me advice, as we would talk things through, she would watch me very intently to see what I was going to do with that information. Did I understand what she was saying? Was I going to implement that in my own life? And would I pass that information on to others? She taught me a lot of good, so yes. Yes, TT. She also taught me a lot of bad, and I'm not gonna pass that on. Yvonne also taught me Scrabble. At a very young age, we would sit down and play Scrabble, and we were Scrabble buddies. And I think that's one of the reasons why I have such an enjoyment for the written language, for written form. While teaching me, she took no pity on me. She didn't mind throwing down a seven-letter word. She didn't mind blocking me, making no space on the board available.
This is when she was just still teaching me how to play it. Not as I got older, but as she was teaching me. But during the time playing Scrabble, when things and people were going on around us, but we were focused on this game together, she taught me how much of a cheater she was. She just seemed to cheat her butt off, and she didn't care. She would throw down some lousy word, and at my young age, I could tell that was BS. And when I would try to challenge it, she went through just her different stages. She would sit there looking stoically at me like, "Do play your move." Of course, that's a word. It's your turn. And as I would press the situation and try to stare at her and understand her body language, which I did end up understanding pretty quickly because she did it often. She cheated often. She would go from dismissing my accusations to feigning offense. She would act all offended all of a sudden. And then when I would start going towards the dictionary and telling her I was going to challenge that mess, she would just get downright indignant about it. It was always ugly to watch. And as the years went by of us playing, she would try so hard to get better and better at lying. But I had watched this gradual progression of how she was trying to cheat me, and so I could catch her in it still. That's one of those things I'm not going to pass on. Growing up, it was always so exciting to have a visit from Auntie, from TT. We'd be excited, my brothers and I. We'd be anticipating all the crazy things that she would do, crazy stuff that she would say, and it would start up pretty immediately after her getting there. She always have different questions for us, usually involving our genitalia or puberty. Trying to figure out if we'd had sex yet. She would just say it in the weirdest ways, and we'd be like, and we would laugh about it. She'd be like, "What are you laughing about? Answer my question." We're looking at mom and daddy. She made it fun to be cussed at and to be told to shut up. Somehow, she'd tell you shut up in a heartbeat and then curse you out. And you'd be like, "I'm going to say those words when I get older too." Kids of my own, it has been hilarious to watch what she does with them and to watch their reactions. I'm pretty sure Jaden got asked if he's had sex. Yep. One particular time, we were sitting around having a lunch with my aunt. It was myself and Jeffrey, my youngest Jeffrey. And my folks, and Yvonne, over at Sunrise at the assisted living place. And we told Yvonne that this was just last year, so Jeffrey was 8. And we told Yvonne that because she was so skinny, so tiny, Jeffrey weighs almost the same weight as she does. And she said, "What?" She turned around and looked at him and said, "Well, you're fat." And he just cracked up laughing so much, just so hard. He was cracking up laughing, and he had tears coming down his eyes. And I was like, "Oh, TT did it again. She hit another generation with this." And I was so happy for her, because we still laugh about it. And when I was sitting there, Jeffrey wanted me to make sure that I told that story to you all. She always had the best ways to keep jokes or a laugh going. Her laugh could be contagious. She would just keep teasing the situation until you all just everybody was breaking down at the same time. We share a lot of laughter in our family. We grew up teasing each other. And Yvonne could give. She could take as well as she could give. So she would tease you, but I mean, you could get right back at her and she would just crack up laughing. Because if it was funny, it was funny. One of the things that I have sincerely missed since she's been sick in general is her spirit for singing. Those of you who did not meet her until later, or maybe until she was sick, you didn't get a chance to see the spirit this woman had for singing, for music. If you put on a Motown record, that was it. You put it on and you could tell that something got a hold of her, because when she heard that song, she would close her eyes. It would usually like do this weird flutter and she would have her eyes rolled up back, right? She would start clapping. She would start snapping her fingers. And she would raise her hand like this and shake it. And go start going through all this before even the first words of the song came on, and she looked like a WWE wrestler about to go at it. But she knew something was about to happen. Something big. And she would do all this, and she would let out this guttural tone that sounded like somebody was getting stabbed. Tell me y'all don't remember that. And then she'd start singing the song and it'd be all messed up. It didn't sound right, but it didn't matter. It didn't matter because Yvonne was about to pour out her soul into that song. Like, I do believe that is one of her truest gifts from God, is that she was able to express herself in that way and make everybody around her feel that. We are in celebration together. This song brought out a moment for us that we can share together. Music seemed to fill her with even more life than she already had, and it beamed through every pore of her body. She made you feel what she must have been feeling. She always was ready to perform like she was in a concert, like she was Beyonce before Beyonce. Watching this over the years, she taught me to shine bright. It didn't even necessarily matter if you were doing it right. Were you feeling it? Was it in your soul? Is it light that you can share with others? And share it. But there was one particular song that every single time I think about her right now, this is the song that I see. That I see her dancing to. That I see her feeling. Oh. I know a place.
down. Somebody help me now.
Come on, y'all, help me.
Help me. Help me now.
Hope you'll be patient with me a little bit. I'm gonna start with a verse from the Bible. That's actually several verses from the Bible. I think a lot of times the Bible can speak for itself and can speak to you in ways that I never could. I think Jesus is a better teacher than I am. And, I better hope that, right? But I'm going to start with that today. And to me, this is one of the guiding passages in my life. And when Aisha called and asked if I'd do the service, the first thing that came up to me about Yvonne was Jesus said, I have come that you might have life. And have it more abundantly. And it's just so getting to hear stories that I've not heard before, and hearing about Yvonne and exactly the person that I got to meet, you know, and I got to meet her later on, you know, and I see that in her life, you know. That you might have life and have it more abundantly. So I'm going to read this. This is Jesus. This is the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus put a lot of stuff into here, but I hope it's some words of comfort to you, and I hope you can just listen to Christ talk, and not me talk, but listen to him talk to you and speak to you today. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. And he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they'll be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and be trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." I hope that you heard God speak to you. And what Jesus said in this sermon really reminds me of who Yvonne was. And the generosity. It's not often in life that you get to meet somebody that just when you're in their presence, you know that they are bigger than what their body can contain. Do you know what I mean? And she was that, right? The passage, the words that really jump out to me in this, just to me, are salt and light. And I kind of see that, not kind of, but really see that in who Yvonne was, who she is. And one of the most difficult things for me to do as a pastor is to speak at the funeral of somebody I don't know. I've done that several times, but I'm so glad that that's not the case today. And I'm so blessed to know the Whitfields and to have them in my life. And I promise you, and Ted and Audrey, that we're going to have that whiskey tasting, I promise. I haven't forgotten, I just can't remember. So, but when all this is past, and I still want to do that and get together and have a good time. So anyway, I hope you indulge me and just, I want to talk about my connection to Yvonne. And it goes beyond just being my good friend's aunt. And Yvonne and I had a lot in common. And you might not see that on the surface. I'm not someone that I don't think you typically call the life of the party. just laugh at me, go ahead, laugh. I'm very introverted, you know, and just a little story. I was at another funeral, and it was a family member, and it was my father-in-law, and some of you guys knew him, and Tim was a manly man, you know what I mean? He was like, you know, two-tour vet, you know, Vietnam, you know, police officer. Like, just manly man, and he passed away a couple of years ago, and we were at the funeral home, and we were talking about flowers, and, you know, my mother-in-law was talking about how she wanted color, you know, she didn't want it to be, like, drab and depressing, she wanted some color, you know, and I said, well, why not we do a rainbow spray, you know, funeral director, who's a family friend, says, "I know what you're doing. You're an instigator." And I was like, "Yes, I am an instigator." And I love that about Yvonne. And I kind of felt that kindred spirit, you know, you love to start stuff, you know? And it's really fun to start stuff and then just step back and let it, you know, and let it happen. And man, she was fun, I mean, she was the life of the party. I loved that little light in her eye that you knew she was just about to say something. You know what I mean? And so she always made things interesting, you know, salt and light, you know. All my interactions with her were seeing that salt and light. I was telling Aisha that this was years ago, but I went to visit her in the hospital, and I forget, I had one of the boys with me. I just think it was Tristan. And we went to just to kind of try to cheer her up, and she cheered us up. I mean, an amazing lady. You know, there's a tendency, I think, at funerals to focus only on the good things, and everyone struggles. Nobody's perfect, but I mean, I look at her life, and I thank God for Yvonne, and I thank God for who she was to me. Hearing her generosity, I felt even a deeper connection hearing some more of the stories. And realizing as I'm sitting here that she reminds me a lot of my mom. And the cheating, oh my gosh. And unfortunately, I did carry that on. I have family members who won't play with me anymore. and singing, oh man. I wish I could have seen that. I wish I could have, you know, been there for that. It's important to me. Well, we honor Yvonne's life. We honor what she meant to us. We grieve the loss of the salt and the light and how it's changed us. I love hearing about how it's changed everybody here. And my prayer is that we can fulfill Jesus' words today. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. May you receive comfort and be the comfort for someone else here today. I'm going to close with Psalm 23, and I hope we can all claim these words and this prayer as our own this morning. After you've spent time in the valley, that you can walk out as salt and light to the people in your life. That you can look to the Lord for strength, for courage, for healing. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Amen. I almost forgot I got responsibilities. The postlude is going to be Aretha Franklin's rendition of Amazing Grace. And if you want to stay and listen, that's great. But this is our postlude, so feel free to leave. And just maybe as you leave, be respectful of people who want to stay and listen and grieve together a little further.
We got a plan.
Did the picture slide that played?
I'm sorry, the
last song.
I don't recall. I'm sorry. We can ask the dog.
We gotta go. Okay.